Okay. So this shir is the last one of the season, and it's the last one on Parshas Miketz. So, 60th shir on Parshas Miketz took us a very long time. Any one of our regular or irregular listeners, if you are interested in having some sort of siyum, you can reach out to me. I'm talking about the non-live audience is welcome to reach out and perhaps arrange some sort of siyum. Okay? Yeah. That will be tonight's shir. Regarding it's also the last shir of the season. We'll be taking off for the rest of August and resuming in Elul. Mitzvah Hashem. The resumption in Elul, we'll figure out. There might be some new mahalach for the shir. We shall see. Stay tuned. Okay. So we're up to the last four psukim in Parshas Miketz, beginning with Perek Nundalad, Pasuk Yudalad, which begins Vayova Yehuda Ve'echov Beisa Yosef. So the brothers are now described as Yehuda and his brothers. And that's because, as we mentioned, Yehuda is going to lead them. And of course, he's going to speak up on their behalf, and he's going to speak on their behalf and then speak up on their behalf. And he's leading them now as a unit, in contrast to the three prior psukim, which describes them as being individuals. Ish es am tachtoi, ish am tachtoi, oldest to youngest, and the youngest is separated off from the rest, having been discovered to have stolen the gviya, and then each of them loads up their donkey. So there's each individual is treated separately, but now they're united once again. Yehuda ve'echav beisa Yosef, and of course the parasha ends on the suspenseful note where Yosef offers to perhaps separate them, and Yehuda insists that no, he stands for all of them, he takes responsibility for all of them. So that starts over here in Pasuk Yudalet, and you'll notice even in Pasuk Tezvav, Yosef speaks to them as a group. We'll get to that soon. V'hu Aydenu Sham, that brings us back to the Mishnah, as we mentioned. This is a continuation of the same scene. They come back to Beis Yosef, where they had the Mishta. Yosef is still there, looking for his missing cup. He's still there at the drinking house, and he's looking for his missing gavia. Vayiplu lefanav arza vayomalehem Yosef. We'll get back to that soon. There's something important here about the fact that they were at this Mishta. There'll be something new to learn from that as well. Vayomalehem Yosef moha maaseh azeh asher asisem. So here, as I mentioned, we have Yosef speaking to them as a collective, which is contrary to the offer made earlier that the Asher al-Besai insisted that no, only the one that stole it is going to be culpable. And yet here he's talking to them as a group. So I think the pshat is because he's testing them. He's saying, look, I'm going to look at you as a group. Let's see if they respond by saying, why are you talking to us? It's not us. It's only one of us, Binyamin. He's going to see if they're going to throw Binyamin under the bus. And they don't. Instead, Yehuda says it's our collective sin. And then Yosef dangles it explicitly in front of them and says, hey, perhaps just, why don't you just leave Binyamin and go? It's all to see how they're going to respond to this offer or this alternative of viewing them not as a collective that's responsible for each other, but whether they'll abandon Binyamin. Okay. Now notice, Mo hamaaseh hazeh asher asiseh. So it repeats asiya twice. Okay, right? You have to notice that. That itself is interesting. And significantly, they did nothing. They actually did nothing. Rather, as the next pasuk says, "Halakim matza esavay nabadecha." In other words, there was no asiya; they did nothing. What actually happened? What did they think happened? They thought that God planted the gavia, this instrument of nichosh, in their amtachas, because He is chasing them and revealing their sins. Publicizing their sins. Okay, so they did nothing now. So very significantly, he's accusing them for a maaseh, and actually there is no maaseh, it's rather God acting. And this idea And this idea appears in Koheles. Exactly where we'd expect it, in the Parak and the Psukim that we keep on going back to, especially in the last year. And that's Parak Yud Aleph. So for the context, you could look at the last year and even the prior shurim, but the main one, the most explicit one perhaps, is Parak Yud Aleph Pasuk Beis, Parak Yud Aleph Pasuk Aleph and Beis, which says that you should send out your lechem al pnei hamayim because it's going to come back 7 years or eight later. That's the bread of Mitzrayim being put away, even though they have the mayim, the river, because you don't know what's coming. There might be a hunger. And there's this theme over here, of course, in Koheles in general, about us not knowing the future. And therefore, having to plan for uncertainty. Okay, and this pasuk says, pasuk hey, says, Ka'asher incho yodea maderech ruach ka'atzamim beten hamaleya. Just like you don't know derech ruach, whatever the next thing means, atzamim beten hamaleya. So something you don't know. So too, you don't know God's actions, who does everything. So what the pasuk is saying is like this. God does everything. You know why I say God does everything? Because what do we know? Memela, if we understood things, memela, if we had das, we could say that we do things. But look, there's so much that we don't have das of. And that tells us that it's not us who are running the world, but it's rather everything is Hashem doing. Okay, so now that brings us back to our pasuk. You notice over there it says there are things you don't know, right? And here Yosef accuses them of, don't you have knowledge? So the message is, you guys don't have knowledge. So why are you acting without knowledge? Meaning to say, not about the subliminal message over here, is in a chanami, they didn't do anything. But that's Yosef's whole point. Yosef's big teaching is, that man does nothing, it's really God. Okay? Yosef wants to reveal that secret to them, and therefore one could plan good and it turns out bad, and one could plan bad and it turns out good. That's the big punchline. And on the basis of that, we say God does everything and man does nothing. On the basis of this ignorance at the heart of the human condition. So therefore Yosef says to them, what is it that you're doing? What is this doing that you're doing? Don't you know? Meaning the fact that you don't know certain things should undermine your ability to do things. It should undermine your belief in the fact that you're doing things. That's the deeper message here. Okay. Fine. Okay, that's the parallel to Koheles, and that's why there's a stress over here that about action and they accept this point that their actions are meaningless and they stop becoming, they're no longer men of action who believe in what they're doing and can explain what they're doing. Rather, they say we cannot explain. God does everything and we are the losers. We are the ignorant ones who are at the mercy of God, and we're not as righteous as we would have thought. In fact, we have an avoin and God has discovered it. Okay. Now, what did he tell them? So, don't you know that someone like me is menachish? Now, earlier we learned that he's menachish with the gavia. Here he's saying, according to many mefarshim, that how do you think you'll get away with it? Don't you know a person like me is menachish? Now, again, menachish meaning, therefore I will figure out through divination who stole, that you guys stole it. And don't you know that? Some say, halo yadatam, don't you know that? Because earlier he did these magical things of knowing who's the oldest and who's the youngest. As the Medrash says, he did that through tapping his gavia. So don't you know that I'm a menachish? Now, but if he's menachish with his gavia, what kind of argument is that? Yeah, we know you're menachish with your gavia, so we stole the gavia and everything's safe. But he says in this passage, don't you know that a person like me is menachish? So in other words, he's shifting the focus from the gavia, and he's saying, don't you know that someone of my stature is menachish? Regardless of whether I have the gavia or not, I am someone who is menachish. So even without the gavia, I'm going to do divination and figure out who stole from me. Now let's think about this. What is this ish asher kamayni? What is this? Yosef is calling upon the fact that there's no ish like, or that an ish like him is a very unique ish. That takes us back to Paroi, who said, "Ein novin v'chacham kamoicha." And ish asher hanimtza chaze, ish asher ruach elikim bay. So Paroi is the one who vouched for Yosef being an ish, an unparalleled kind of ish. He says, "Hanimtza chaze ish asher asher ruach elikim bay, and ein novin v'chacham kamoicha." So here Yosef is calling on Paroi's great praise to say, you know, that I'm a someone like me is very special.